Welcome everyone to the California Academy of Sciences. Thanks for joining us today. It's time for our opinion feed this afternoon. Well, we would not be able to do it without the help of our opinion biologist, Amy. So everybody, give a big round of applause to Amy today. Good afternoon, Amy. Good to see you as always. It's Penguins, our esteeming. I'm very excited to see you because you have some food for them in that wonderful bucket. Now, are you heading down to the water to feed them today? So in the water, you'll be handing these birds a couple of different types of fish. But what types of fish are they?
Okay, I have two different types. I have a larger one called a herring. It's a little bit more fatty. I have a smaller one called a capelin. It's a little bit more of a protein-packed fish. And a lot of these birds actually have a preference between the two different types. So you might see me switching around depending on who I'm feeding. But between the two, they get a really well-balanced diet.
That's fantastic. We feed all of our animals here sustainably, which means that we're using resources that aren't taking too many things out of the natural environments. So as you chat about which types of fish they might hunt in the wild, Amy, I'm just going to go to the audio panel, bump your volume down just one notch, and then I'll be right back with you. So what types of fish might they be hunting out in the wild, Amy? Absolutely. It's a very good cause and make sure that we aren't taking too many things away from the populations of penguins that are already struggling to find enough resources out in their natural habitat. And if all of you want to help out as well, I have a handful of these seafood watch cards with me. It's a program through the Monterey Bay Aquarium. Options in green on the back are types of seafood you can get from sushi restaurants that have been sustainably sourced. Options in yellow are okay for now, but options in red you want to avoid for the time being. If you want to pick one of these up, see me after the show, and then we'll have a chance to contribute to the health of these animals as well. You can also go to the Seafood Watch app. That's a great way to contribute to that health as well. Absolutely. Those folks in the front, if you could please have a seat for us, that'll allow people behind to see. I know it's tough to get everyone involved here. We'll do our best to make it possible for all of you. Now we're in for a treat right now because we're seeing all of these birds swimming down in different depths of this exhibit. But how deep might a penguin be able to dive in the wild?
Yeah, they can dive usually to about maybe 60 to 100 feet, but they can hold their breath for about 2 to 2.5 minutes, and if they need to, they can dive to 300 or 400 feet.
So they can dive extremely deep if necessary, holding their breath during that time. They are air breathers like every other type of bird, but they have some adaptations in their body that allow them to dive better than other birds that you might see up on the surface. So what is it about their bones, perhaps, that might be different from other types of birds?
Yeah, so these guys have more dense or solid bones as opposed to flying birds that have hollow bones, and that makes them heavier. So if you compare these guys to the macaws that are in the rainforest, they're about the same size, but those macaws are about 2 pounds. These guys range from about 5 pounds to 10 pounds, so they're a lot heavier, and that's one of the main reasons why they can't fly, so they're just too heavy. So that that weight and that bone structure is really beneficial to them when diving to get those fish.
So it is a trade-off. They're incredible. Their denser bodies allows them to catch food in that water environment, but they've had to sacrifice their ability to fly through the air. But when they look around and swim, they're still using the same muscles that flighted birds use, but instead to propel them through the water with those compact wings. They still have wings, but they're shaped more like flippers. That's an excellent way they can propel up to 12 miles an hour through the water. And to give that context, that's more than twice as fast as the very fastest Olympic human swimmers can manage. So they're excellent hunters in that environment. But how much of a proportion of their day might they spend out to sea hunting if they was up on land and out on the rocks? To their young that are not ready to go out to sea to catch those food items. But how long do those juveniles stay up on land before they start hunting on their own?
Usually about 2 to 3 months or so. So when they're first hatched out, they have a fluffy downy layer of feathers, which makes them not waterproof. So they need to depend on their parents during that time to get their food. And then once they get that waterproof layer of feathers around 3 months, then they're ready to go on their own.
So they'll be hunting on their own, but do their parents still care for them afterwards? Or do they have to start fending for themselves in terms of protecting their own territories as well?
Yeah, once they leave that nest, they're pretty much on their own. Those parents have to take care of them. It's a lot of work having to feed them probably 6, 7, 8 times a day to regurgitate that fish for them. So once they leave the nest, they're on their own.
Fantastic. So they mature very quickly. Birds of all sorts mature very fast compared to other types of birds, certainly faster than most mammals do. So it's fascinating to see that aspect of their life history playing out also sometimes in captivity, because here in captivity, we do breed these penguins on occasion to help keep this species going nice and strong into the future. But how do we select the partners to make sure that there's healthy offspring? That's an excellent cause to help make sure the African penguin, which is very endangered, stays strong for decades and decades to come into the future. While those issues are still being worked on out in the wild, it's not safe to re-release these birds. There aren't enough resources to go around, but thankfully the Academy is partnering with some great organizations to keep the health of the species going as strong as it possibly can. All right, folks, it's time to take some questions. If anybody has a question for Amy, raise your hand and I'll relay that message inside the exhibit. We'll try to answer this for you right now. If anybody has a penguin question, try to make sure I can look around and catch everyone. Let's see. Yes? How many fish does a penguin eat per day?
They eat a lot of fish. These birds eat about 1 pound of fish per bird per day, which doesn't really sound like a lot, but like I said, these birds only weigh about 5 to 10 pounds, so it ends up being about 14% of their body weight. I feed anywhere between 180 to 240 fish every single day, and that's for 14 birds.
That's astonishing. The kind of analogy that I've learned is it would be relatively similar to an adult person eating about 20 hamburgers at a time. So it's a lot for their body size, but because they have a very fast metabolism, they have to keep their bodies going in relatively underwater environments, not super cold like Antarctic penguins might be encountering, but water that's in the 60s. For animals that have to maintain a body temperature that's much higher than that, it's a lot of energy.